part of my dissertation that I've been conducting for the past 3 years. And it's actually a comparison between how Mexican migrants engage in politics in Brussels and in Paris. And this paper is just in relation to Brussels. So why is this relevant? From December 2016, there have been a lot of people that have been intentionally killed in Mexico. And there are a lot of reports on disappearances, cases of torture and human rights violations. So I would argue that it's a context of conflict, even if there is a literature on diasporas in conflict that I'm going to discuss about it later, but there is not yet a consensus that there is a conflict in Mexico per se. There are a few colleagues working on the context of violence, which is already very good for this area of studies. So during my, in this paper, I argue that artistic practice, well, after looking at how Mexicans engage and the different ways that they engage, I've noticed that actually they don't, especially in Brussels, they don't engage in a very, nor consistent, nor systematized, or in a very political structured way. So that's why I think it would be relevant for this case to analyze arts as an original case and repertoire of contention. And why? Because artistic practices are a key component of social movements. And I will also introduce this part of the social movement theories that has been developed after 2010 specifically. And they create a collective sense of belonging. So the community starts being quite solid, or at least there are certain groups. Then it leads to vitalizing emotions, and they evoke memories. So that's why arts represent an original repertoire of contention, or that's how I try to frame it in this paper. So in order to do that, I introduced the concept of subjectivity, which, once again, I find it relevant. Let me just, I shouldn't do this, but maybe it's clearer. So this is the evolution of social movement theories. In the morning, we have discussed a lot about the process theory, the PPT, but then, in diasporas in conflict, we focus in the three in the middle. So framing, opportunities and structures, resources and framing. So nowadays in the literature on social movements, there has been an extra box over here that is the term subjectivation. So what I'm trying to do is to bring this term, which has been developed mostly in the French literature and in Latin America, to the studies of these practices in Belgium. Okay. So subjectivity is relevant because it manages to unpack the capacity of actors to construct their own existence, the control of their experiences, and to be responsible and creative to engage in social movements. So here we're actually focusing at a macro level of analysis. It's really individual, and it was very relevant to pick ethnography because I could really be immersed in the life of the Mexican community in both countries. So I have two main research questions. The first one is, how are Mexican migrants becoming political subjects and creating spaces of transnational political activism in reaction to the context of violence in the homeland? And what makes them use art as a repertoire of contention against violence in their hometowns? The aims of this paper are basically, to present the art as an unconventional form of political participation to demonstrate that Mexican migrants in Brussels first enhance individual processes of subjectivation and inter-subjectivation when they are together, then to detach themselves from state institutions, in part because they don't trust the Mexican authorities, and this is related to corruption and violence in the home country. Third, to develop and sustain creative forms of political mobilization, which they do in different forms, such as singing, playing music, festivals, gastronomy. And then the final one is to create spaces of self-reflection and self-awareness. So in this type of, in these events that they they do, they start talking and sharing experiences, and then they start actually thinking about how to engage differently and in politics. So the theoretical framework, I use three main literatures. The first one is transnational politics, which we have seen a little bit this morning, and I'm sure you all know about them. But the main focus is on political participation institutionalized. So we don't really analyze boycotts, strikes, demonstrations, writing letters, and artistic representations in this literature. So with my paper, I aim to contribute on that section by looking at different ways of transnational engagement. The second literature is diaspora mobilization, which focuses on authoritarian regimes and countries in conflict or historically in conflict, like it can be the Palestinian and Israeli conflict, or the Irish conflict, or ETA. So what I'm trying to do is also to analyze these tools that have been provided by this specific literature, and to contribute by bringing the term of, the concept and all the qualities of subjectivation and subjectivity in the specific study of social movements. And finally, the last theories that I use is subjectivation, and which I found relevant because they, and as I said, specifically after 2010, people are organizing differently and they are engaging differently in social movements. Yeah, and basically it's in practices and their values. So it's a very individual way of engaging. In the literature, the most, let's say, the easiest one to remember is in terms of the ecological movement. So people would bring their bags to the supermarket instead of using the plastic bags. So these little these little actions and that are actually fed by personal values of the individuals are what leads to subjectivation of people. So that, well, very simply put, this is what the theory says. So I focus on the individual, which I would argue is the core piece of social movements. Then another characteristic of this subjectivation is the detachment of the institutions and formal organizations. So this can come, it's very easily because it's easily traceable because they call their own friends. So the movement starts just with three or four people that are actually friends. So the personal connections are very important for this type of movements. Finally, creativity and self-fulfillment. And the activists, as I told you, create new spaces of experience and subjectivation. So for my research, I conducted 23 semi-structured interviews among the so-called political leaders or political entrepreneurs in the Mexican diaspora in Brussels for this paper. And I participated in 42 events as participant observant. And that was very interesting because I could see how they demonstrate, how they organize the groups and the group dynamics. And I attended different events such as political demonstration, music rehearsals, charity concerts, artistic performances, planning meetings, and political debates. And during all this data collection process, I had different roles, and I think I analyzed it deeper in the text. But I had to cook, I took pictures, I danced with them, I was playing music. So all these different tools were very relevant to have access to the way they engage. Even if I'm a terrible musician, I had to do it to have access to them. And that was challenging, but yet really fruitful for the research, I think. So this is the research methods. So with this, I divided the paper in four, in the four arguments and the four aims. So the first one is the individual or access of research, and the first one is the individualization of transnational social movements. So activists describe themselves as political actors, and they really engage in terms of their values, and this is obviously it's a mix of their migration experience, their talents, and the historical, the association with the homeland, so this diasporic element that Cohen talks about. Then they have different motivations. personal emotions, moral obligations, and sense of responsibility. This was really interesting to see when there was an earthquake that happened in Mexico City. The emotional level was really intense, and in 2 days they organized a huge event where they could had access to 5,000 euros in 4 hours. And I think that was a very clear example of the type of mobilization they can do. So obviously the context of violence and insecurity in Mexico or the homeland is very important, because that's what triggers their engagement. They keep reading the news, they keep calling their parents. So this transnational dimension is also relevant for this case. So for example, I have a quote here of a graphic designer that lives not too far from Brussels. How can I explain? I cannot resist doing it. It would be to go against my own interests, my convictions, not to mobilize myself for the tragedies going on in Mexico. Today, I think it is important. I think I have an inner conflict with myself to know that Mexico gave me all, my studies and my families. So we can see that they have a moral obligation to engage in political events, even if they are not living in Mexico anymore. And age is, the time spent in the homeland, obviously I know my sample is small, but it's not, I wouldn't say it's important, because some people started engaging when they had only 4 months in Belgium, and others when they had 22 years. So I could see actually all the spectrum, and I'm looking at the, specifically at the political entrepreneurs. So like people that are already engaging in these movements, but the time spent in the hostland is relevant to make connections, but it's not a determinant, I would say, in triggering their will to engage in politics. The second one, characteristic that I think it's important to talk about in terms of subjectivation and social movements for the Mexican case is the informal organization. So as I was telling you, it might look simple, but they really rely on their friends to keep this movement going on. So there is a core, maybe it's three or four people most of the times, and then they would make a bigger call for the Mexican diaspora, the Latin American diaspora. So it's like a domino effect, but the core is very interpersonal. So in the case of Mexican activists in Brussels, this pattern was very similar, where the interpersonal relations are very, very important. And migrant activists tend to privilege interpersonal relationships to organize and diffuse their political messages. And also to have more resources, to have more opportunities, to have access to venues, which is also important for the organization and the logistics of the events. There are three main elements that may explain the preference to engage informally in transnational politics. The first one is the absence of institutionalized channels between the Mexican state and Mexicans in Belgium. So 98% of Mexicans abroad, so it's 20 million Mexicans abroad, and 98% are in the US and in Canada, so there are little efforts in Europe. So I would say, there are not institutionalized channels, but on top of that, there is a lack of trust in the Mexican state and authorities. And this has been argued already for by La Flor and Calderon already in the US. So it's not just for Mexicans in Europe. And finally, the self-consciousness and subjectivity and intersubjectivity of the activists themselves, which is fed by these experiences shared in these events. The third point is engaging in transnational politics through creative and spontaneity. So now we're getting into the artistic part. And I think it was key to, specifically for the Mexicans living in Brussels, creativity and arts were the main way that they engaged in politics from abroad, through concerts, as I already told you, and gastronomic events. And I think it's important for them because it's a way they become political subjects, but it's also a way to create a new repertoire of contention and to gain the attention of people that just passed by. So, for example, I remember one day we were in Brussels and we made a graffiti, and I think I have a picture. Yeah. So we made this graffiti, and people passing by were asking what it was. So actually, it was a way of engaging with tourists or people from Brussels and to spread their messages. So I think they really stressed a lot on it's an original way of gaining the attention in a different form. And obviously to express their emotions freely because it's, well, it's art, so they felt that. I had a very interesting interview with a musician. He's actually a technician and he also is a musician. And he organized Son Jarocho, which is a rhythm from Mexico, kind of. I'm stretching it maybe like flamenco, but like... but like the similar colors and everything. So it was really interesting to talk to him because he really stressed that the originality and the alternative way of engaging, not only with Mexicans and inviting them to change the lyrics of the music, but also, once again, to actually spread the message to people that were passing by, Europeans and even tourists. So he said, well, I'm going to shorten it, but I use music as a channel to inform the people in Europe about what is happening in Mexico. And this is the least that I can do for my country. Music and art are weapons for the future, and we can use them for our benefit. Through art, it is possible to raise awareness, more so than with a political banner. I think my jarana, which is the little guitar, it's my rifle, I see it that way. So I think that this sentence really captures all the different forms of subjectivity that I presented in the theoretical part. Finally, how they create spaces of experiences through art and politics. Using the same model, let's say, of calling their friends, engaging with the connections that they already have, and using their talents and capacities, they create these alternative spaces. And it's a really free atmosphere where people come and share maybe a drink or a cake or a taco for this matter. And then it's interesting to see how people actually start engaging in politics without having that, without having a formal conversation, but just sharing how probably a neighbor had a problem with in terms of insecurity, and then they start raising awareness among themselves. So this is the last example, I guess, the mural painting. This is actually, they are trying to do it every year. They don't do them at the same date, but more or less summer. That's also something that I should mention, that weather was very important to determine how they wanted to engage, because in Brussels, well, it rains a lot, and then they don't have access to this nice weather, so that also has an impact on how they engage in politics. And the conclusions. So the context of violence in Mexico has triggered and shaped the transnational way, well, the transnational activities that Mexican migrants in Brussels have developed, first by enhancing their emotions of commitment and moral obligation. Second, by inspiring the form of the artistic movements and context of their political representations. And finally, by accelerating their processes of self-reflection, self-consciousness, self-empowerment, and then their processes of becoming political subjects. And that's it. Yeah.